Good day. I'm back once more. As I keep reminding all of us that the one single factor that affects our well-being, contentment, satisfaction, motivation, even success to a great extent, one single factor is relationships. Good relationships, and you can face any hurdle, any setbacks, and you can still move on. Relationships are bad. The smallest external threat pulls us down. And when I talk about relationships, to some extent it is true about all relationships, but I am more particular about our close relationships. As you know, we have our circle of socializing. We have the external, the furthest one is what we would call as a social circle. Your friends, your colleagues, the shopkeeper from where you buy things or whatever, all these people whom you do meet on a regular basis, or maybe somebody you go for a walk with or somebody you meet in the club. But you do not have much of an emotional attachment. And if that person is no longer there in your circle, it doesn't disturb you, move on to somebody else. Inside that is the personal circle. That includes people who are maybe your parents, your siblings, your besties, as the youngsters would like to call. Even maybe in the office, you have somebody who's not just a colleague, but means something more to you. You may even have some friend who is living in the other end of the world, but you still stay emotionally connected. All these people are your personal circle of influence. And then the innermost is what I would call as the intimate circle. People with whom you are very intimate. It could be your partner, it could be children, it could be your mother, whoever it is. Now, in this, what happens is that we have closer and not so close relationships. There was a time when all relationships were more or less defined. We used to live, you know, 3-4 generations back also, we used to live in a sort of village setup where the hierarchy was laid down, joint families. The oldest person, however infirm he may be, was the ultimate. He was the person who ruled over his brood and his clan. All our extended relatives, everybody more or less had a definition. Now we have moved in the last one or two generations into undefined relationships. I may be working far away from my hometown. So I may be having very close people. I may be having siblings or parents or whoever it is. But they don't live with me. They don't even live in the same city. And added to that, most of them have become so busy that we can't even visit them or invite them to come and visit us, because they have their own preoccupation. They have their own priorities and stuff like that. So what do we do in that case? If I live in a particular city and I don't have my intimate people, close people there, what I do is I create that, relationships to fill in that vacuum. And that is what I define as undefined relationships. Let's say I fall sick. Normally I would expect my mother or my sister to come and stay with me in the hospital, but they're not available to me. My mother's too old and is in the hometown. My sister is very busy with her children and family and all that. So I may have a neighbor who says, doesn't matter, I'll take care of you, I'll come and stay with you. Or alternatively, the neighbor may say, since you have a child whom you cannot leave alone, you send the child to my house. I'll take care of the child while you go and get your treatment done and come back. So like this, we are moving more and more and more towards undefined relationships. In this now, the factor that comes in is the fact that we all want to be special to somebody. There was this friend, in fact, a teacher of mine long, long, long back, who used to say that we all have this desire to be the most important person in somebody's life. If you feel that there is at least one human being to whom you are the most important person, not necessarily the most loved, not necessarily living with you, not necessarily close to you or spending time with you. No, the most important person, give it a thought. At that time, I also didn't understand much of what she was saying, but over a period of time, it has grown onto me that there is a human desire to feel that I am the most important person in somebody's life. And that gives tremendous motivation to us. In fact, you may have heard of Viktor Frankl, who spent 3-4 years in the German concentration camps. He was a qualified psychiatrist and neurologist. And he wrote a book after coming out called Man's Search for Meaning. It started with Sigmund Freud, who said that we all crave for love. Freud's, student who was very close to him for some time and then he moved away from him, he started saying that man thrives on power. So Freud said love, Adler said power. Viktor Frankl said meaning. If you have a meaning in life, you can face any adversity. And that's what he did. As a person who was, subjected to the worst possible cruelty, we won't do that to an animal also. And he survived because he said, I had a meaning. And what was that meaning in his case? He was a youngster. I think he must have been early 30s when he was locked up in the concentration camp. And he had a wife whom he loved immensely. He used to visualize, dream, fantasize about his wife. In minutest detail, he used to think, when I finally come out of this, when we win the war and all the prisoners are released, I will be back with my wife. And you know what he started thinking? We will have this house, which will have a nice big drawing room. We'll put a thick carpet of beige color. We will paint the walls in light green. We'll have a lighting system and some lights coming down from the ceiling. We'll have a fireplace. We'll probably have a dog of such and such breed who will be sitting next to me. I will be reading a particular book and then discussing that from time to time with my wife. He started visualizing that in the minutest detail. And he said, that is what gave me a meaning to life. And that is how I could survive the worst of physical and mental torture. So the lesson we learn from such people is that good, special relationships can actually give you a meaning in life. Where you may be floundering because your career is not doing good, or you may not be keeping very good health and every now and then you have some health issues, or you may be going through a financial crisis or whatever you are going through, if you have a meaning to sustain you. And in most of the cases, the meaning lies in close and good relationships. And that is what I thought I will share with you today about what is this desire and why to feel special, to have somebody special in your life. Let's say there's a housewife, homemaker. She's not doing any external career and all that. She is happy taking care of the family. She has a son and she takes immense care of her son. Her whole life revolves around the son. But the son is not a very nice fellow. He's naughty, he's rebellious. He does all sorts of bad things. She gets very upset now and then with the child, but she not only continues to love him, she also continues to be totally attached to him, take care of all his needs and wants. Now, let's say in the next door neighbor's house, there's another child, and that child is very attached to this lady. Under any pretext, he comes over, he talks very nicely, he is very, very respectful of her. With that child, she can carry out very meaningful discussions. He's also very obedient. He's very sensitive to the needs of this lady. Auntie, did you have food? Auntie, are you okay with this? Auntie, I saw that you were limping. Is there something wrong with your knee or something like that? That is what the child is doing. Now, normally you would expect a person to start giving more and more attention to the neighbor's child, isn't it? But in reality, does not happen. She'll be very nice to the neighbor's child. She'll give him attention now and then. But her prime focus will be her own child. Why? Despite the fact that the child is not being very nice to her. Because that sense of being special. I am the one and only mother to this child. Doesn't matter if he doesn't behave nicely with me. It starts with that. And it goes on to any and every relationship. I keep talking about how Indian women get married, the typical orthodox arranged marriage, and things start going downhill. The husband is not at all nice to her. She's exceptionally nice to the husband. She makes all efforts to sort of, bring him down a little bit so that he'll mellow down and be nice to her. She does everything to win over his love. No result. Nothing is happening. He not only continues to be insensitive to her, his behavior keeps getting worse and worse. Now, supposing this wife does not have any restrictions. She's financially independent. She has a good name in society. Her parents give her unconditional love. Wherever you want to be, we will back you up. If you don't want to live with your husband, just come over and we'll take care of you. We'll be as a family to each other. Despite knowing all that, she doesn't quit. She keeps hanging on to her husband. Why does that happen? Because the person feels that I am special in this person's life. I am one person who is exclusive. And that gets manifested in very simple ways, Supposing the husband does something bad, he gets into some financial fraud or some such thing, and because of that, he is jailed. She knows that he has done the fraud. It's not that she believes that he is innocent. She knows that he has done it, and that is why he has been put in jail. But she will still be very kind to him. She'll probably pack tiffin and take it and give it to him in jail. She'll try to take care of whatever needs of his. Okay. Now let us say that instead of doing a financial fraud or instead of getting involved in some violent activity or something, the husband gets into an extramarital affair with some married woman or something like that. And that blows out of proportion and he is jailed. The wife will not support him at all. Because what has he done? His action shows you are not special to me. I can go and have an affair with another woman. Whereas in the first case, even though the person was doing a lot of bad things, somewhere or the other, she still had that attachment that this person is close to me. And I am his one and only spouse or partner or whatever you want to say. Take another very oversimplistic example. A man goes abroad or to some other city or somewhere on work. He comes back. Wife welcomes him very warmly. And he comes and he opens a suitcase and pulls out a very nice, pretty sari or dress or whatever it is and says, I got this for you. And she is absolutely thrilled. She feels immense love for her husband at that moment. He remembered me and he went and bought this for me and he brought it for me. But by the time she can celebrate, he pulls out another sari and says, I brought this for my mother. Suddenly that joy and that celebration doesn't look all that great.
After all, he had bought it for his own mother, no? So what difference does it make? No. He didn't think of me exclusively, he bought for me and he brought for his mother. And things get to a head if he pulls out a third sari and says, you know, my secretary has been so nice to me for years and years. She makes my work so much easier. So I bought one sari for her. Finished. The entire joy is gone. Now, these are things which happen on a day-to-day basis, but we don't even realize, we don't give it, you know, that type of attention that we should and think of what is happening. Look at a very simple thing. If a person is very deeply in love with his spouse, partner, whatever you want to call it, the person says, I will love you forever and forever. Now, are you an astrologer? How do you know that you will love this person 1 year, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years from now on? But so confidently they say that. And when they say that, what happens is the other person is getting a reassurance that this is not just for today, it is lifelong. He is not going to love anybody else except me. Even the person hearing this knows very well that how can this person predict the future? I have seen so many couples where they were madly in love with each other for a long time. Then they had a fight or they, you know, got some disruptions and all that. And now they're very angry with each other or they've broken off from each other. But despite knowing that this happens on a regular basis here and there, the person actually starts believing, no, it will not happen to me. Because I am special for this person. I literally belong to this person. Now, here comes a very, very significant thing. Nobody belongs to anyone. You just do not belong to anyone. I always keep quoting the famous poet and writer from Lebanon 100 years back, Khalil Gibran. Just read the passage of Khalil Gibran about partners or spouses. He has put it in such a beautiful way that you do not belong to each other. He has given a simile saying that you are like the two strong pillars which hold up the temple roof. And the pillars, while they are very close to each other, they do not touch. If the pillars come close and touch, the roof will fall down. What a beautiful example. I'm just giving you one quote from it. You can read it up leisurely if you are interested in that. Okay, so what do we need when we have this type of feeling? We want continuous validation. I want to know that even now I am important to this person. Let's say I have a child and the child is very, very attached to me. And he's always running behind me and telling me that, no, I love you. I want you to do this. If the child has to go out, no, you come with me or you drop me or something. Now, as the child grows up, the child becomes independent. In fact, the child doesn't want you. The child says that, you know, I look like a baby in front of my friends if you come and drop me or you are there with me. I want to go by myself. Believe me, a lot of parents cannot take that. And this is only when the child has become semi-independent. What happens when the child grows up and flies out of the nest, which is inevitable? If you have a child who is growing up, your desire should be that your child should become independent, should go and stake his own future, as we say. Maybe go to the best of educational institutions, take up a job somewhere, get married, have his own family. But no, somewhere deep down this thing is there that, am I still important to my own child? And this I have seen on a continuous basis. Because when you have this strong feeling that need to feel special, and if we find we are not getting the type of attention and affection that makes us feel special, unconsciously, what we start doing is trying to control the other person. Trying to control somebody, be it your child, be it your parent, be it your sibling, be it your spouse, is a clear sign that I am not complete within myself. So I want to hang on to this person as a pillar of support. If I am complete within myself, if I say that I am a pillar which holds up my own existence and my own being, the nearest relationships should be what we call as the icing on the cake. Your nearest person, people whom you are closest to, should not be your bread and butter, should not be your food. They should be the dessert that enriches your dinner. If you try to make people your basic nourishment, somewhere or the other, you are headed for difficulties. Either the person feels suffocated and starts moving out, and then it becomes worse for you. Or there are differences and both of you are not connecting with each other the way you used to connect years back. Or in the worst case, the person dies. What do you do in those circumstances? You have put all your eggs in one basket, and suddenly that basket is cracked open. I have seen people becoming very, very miserable. One of my students, who's a medical doctor, works with geriatric care. And the other day, you know, she had come for one of my programs on mindfulness. And she was telling me that I have seen so many couples who have been happily married for 40, 50, 60 years. And then one of them passes away. She says, in so many cases, because I take care of geriatric patients, in so many cases, I have found that the other person passes away within a span of few months or maximum 1 or 2 years. Why should that happen? If I celebrate that I spent 50 years or 70 years with my spouse and it was a good time, I enjoyed it, I can live on those memories and give myself a new purpose or new meaning in life. But that doesn't happen. Why? Because you put all your eggs in one basket. If you had a close friend who was saying that, come, we'll go out together, we'll spend time together. No, I have to be with my spouse. If somebody else is asking you to do something, you say, no, my spouse will be left alone. I want to be there and I want to do this for my spouse. When that happens, as I said, all your eggs which have been put into one basket can just, collapse. And you can, be made to feel special. The best way to be made to feel special is when you show somebody that I care for you, I love you, I am willing to go out of the way to do things for you out of my own choice, not because I want to cling on to you or not because I'm expecting reciprocation, but because you're a good human being and I consider myself fortunate that I have you in my life, so I will do this. But if you don't like it, if you don't reciprocate, I am not going to buckle or collapse. My life will still go on. I had a very good incident which reinforces this long back. There was this 75-year-old lady who used to come to me. She was married to a gentleman who had crossed 80. They had had a very good life together. And their children grew up and became independent. Their grandchildren had come to the stage where they were becoming independent and they had grown up. So like when they were tiny, they used to keep coming to grandmother, grandfather and all that. Now they were becoming independent and they hardly had time for grandma or grandpa. And suddenly out of the blue, the husband started pointing out a lot of critical things about the wife. I don't like this, I don't like that. And very small things. I had that cup of tea 3 hours back. Why is the cup still lying here? Why is that kept in this position? The newspaper should be kept on that desk and not on this desk. Such small things. he started getting very irritable with her, and she was miserable. And to add to that, he started saying, if you don't behave properly, I'll throw you out of the house. I will divorce you. It was so shocking for her at that age to be told such a statement. When we were discussing, I made her think, can you live without your husband if something happens or he leaves you and goes away? She said, yes, he's crossed 80. His health is not as good as it used to be. I'm even mentally prepared that he may not last very long. It's okay, I can do without him. I love him immensely, but I can do without him. I put this poser to her. Do you feel like telling that to him? She thought over and said, yeah, why not? I'll tell him. So next time he was threatening that I'll throw you out of the house, she said, okay, if my being around is making life so miserable for you, I don't want to torture you. So if you really feel so, since you've told it to me so many times, I think we may as well part. The only difference is this apartment belongs to me. So you're not going to throw me out. You're going to walk off from here. It sounds almost comical. He stared at his wife for 5 minutes. Then she could see tears coming down his face. Then he slid down from the sofa, came to where she was sitting, held both her legs, and started crying, saying, don't ever leave me and go. This is a real life incident. Of course, one of them has passed away now, but they did live together after that. This is what I want you to understand. Why should we succumb to this feeling that I have to be special in somebody's life? And remember, all relationships are dynamic. They keep changing. And all relationships have to be nurtured. If I really want to be special, if I really want X, Y, or Z to consider me as the ultimate or the closest or the most important person in their life, I have to keep nurturing the relationship, and I have to give to the other person what the other person wants. There's a proverb which says, do unto others how you would like them to do to you. I don't agree. Do unto others what they would like from you. If I have a friend who loves to have coffee, so whenever he comes, I know that he's a coffee lover. I see to it that I serve coffee to him. I don't like coffee. When I go to his place, he goes on insisting, don't go without coffee, have a cup of coffee. It's getting on to lunchtime. I don't want to have coffee at this time. It'll spoil my appetite. No. You come after so many days. How can you go without having coffee? Whenever I come to your place, you give me coffee. See the fallacy in this whole argument? But if he understands what I want and gives it to me, my relationship with him will nurture. And this, as I said, can be among friends, it can be among relatives, it can be among people who are in your own intimate circle. And that ensures that while we talk a lot about addiction to chemical substances, to mobile and internet, to so many things, we keep talking about addiction. Addiction to people also can be very harmful. And this addiction happens when we have this very strong need to feel special. And that is what I want you to understand. I thought I'd leave you with these thoughts. And I'm definitely open to discussions and comments and criticism and different viewpoints, as always. And I already see that things have started coming up on the chat box. But I will take my 1 minute break and I will be back. And Sonal is here to update you on what's happening.
Good afternoon, everyone. A very good afternoon, lovely weather, lovely talk. We all want to feel special. We all feel that, yeah, I need something sometime more. And we want to give also to others, right? Lovely, I was enjoying the talk, what Ali was speaking. A lot of introspection was also happening. Same as with you also, I think so. Yeah. To tell you what's happening at Banjara. On Monday, the 10th, we are having our inauguration of Certificate in Child and Adolescent Development Program, which is an online program, just to tell you. It's a four-month online program where you will be getting videos of the lessons where Ali and other faculties will be talking. As you enjoy listening to Ali this way, even the program of CCAD is also about that. And you will have an exclusive mentoring session also for the all 4 months, for all the 16 classes, what you will have online mentoring program, as well as 16 lessons, which will be in a video form. And the inauguration is happening on 10th, that is Monday. So if anybody whom you think are interested in knowing about children, why do they behave, how they behave, what happens at specific age, right from pregnancy to adolescence, everything is covered in that course. Then next is on 6th of July, we have one more session on mindfulness. Last Saturday also, we had a workshop on mindfulness and people really loved it. They understood what actually mindfulness is, not only about doing what you're doing at this moment, but beyond that. So if anybody is interested or you are interested in participating in that workshop, you can inquire at office, Anis, Jennifer, Banu, any one of them can help you out in that. And this month end, the favorite diploma course of all of us, Diploma in Counseling Skills, the 26th batch is going to start on 29th afternoon. And on 29th morning, we have a workshop to understand counseling skills. So if there is someone who wants to know what is counseling and what are those skills all about, in a, you know what you call, in a gist, you can ask them to join this workshop. It will be a very comprehensive, beautiful workshop and by Dr. Ali. So these are the updates from Banjara. Apart from that, free counseling. Do not forget to spread the word to anyone in need. And if even if somebody wants to say that, no, there's nothing, but I want to know what is counseling all about, you can still send them to Banjara. You know how it goes. As in when we talk, we understand something, they understand something, relationship starts building, right? So that's about Banjara. Have a great weekend. And Ali is back here in studio.
Yes, I'm back. And I saw a lot of good afternoons, good days and all that. But we have some comments also, which are equally interesting. Sridevi says, I used to enjoy my parenting as I used to work as a teacher along with them and some other part-time jobs, learning some courses as a coach and all. But now when my children have become adults, I still do some courses from great mentors like you, Dr. Ali, Sridhar sir, etc. I feel like I found my meaning for my life in my clients now, where I get 100% job satisfaction as I am following my passion of service, be it paid most of the time. Sridevi has brought out a very, very interesting thought that your meaning in life, the thing that motivates you, can change from time to time. As I was explaining just a few minutes back, Sridevi at one time may have been totally focused on her children. Obviously, children mean a lot to a mother. But when the children become adults, if you can switch over and put your focus, including relationships. Can you let go of your own child who says, I don't want to live with you. I want to get married. I want to have my own family. And yeah, once in a while, I will come and visit you. Or if there is a need, you call me. I'll be there for you. But you are obviously no longer the most important person in my life. You are not that special as you were to me when I was growing up. Today, maybe my spouse is more important. My child is more important. I know of cases where a woman gets married and she develops a beautiful relationship with her mother-in-law. And her mother starts feeling jealous. You never come and visit me. You go and spend all your time with your mother-in-law. This is a sign that there is somewhere this dependency has come in. And you know that you are getting your daughter married. She will be with her in-laws or whatever it is. And she will develop new relationships where you may not be as special as you were earlier. Because at that time, she had only one mother figure. Now she has two of them, right? Okay. Sridevi also says, thankful and grateful forever. My brilliant and bright mentor. Yes, Sridevi, we also appreciate your growth and whatever you have been doing. Very meaningful work. Okay, Surekha says, when somebody makes us feel special, it definitely allows us to feel better. But does it help us to live better and to respond to challenges more appropriately and more resourcefully? The answer, very simply, Surekha, is no. When somebody is nice to us, when somebody makes us feel special, let us enjoy that. Let us relish that. It is like, you know, you go to somebody's house and they make a sweet which is exquisite, far better than any other sweet that you have eaten. What do? You relish it. You thank the person who has made it and given it to you. You show your appreciation and you move on. You don't keep thinking all the time back to that sweet. Where will I get it from? No. Maybe because you have appreciated it, next time that person may again call you or may come over to your place with that sweet and give it to you. So that becomes a bonus. But if I say that now I don't like any other sweet because once I ate that sweet, I'm totally attached to that. See the disappointment that comes in. You will not be able to enjoy anything else. So the same thing happens in relationships. Okay. Surekha also says the need to feel special may make us feel that what others think of me is more important than what I think about myself. Surekha, as usual, comes out with very thought-provoking statements. And this is one of them. What I think about myself should be more important than what others think about me. Why do I have to depend on others' opinions? Why do I have to get that reinforcement continuously that you are special to me, you are great to me, I love you beyond anything and everything? All relationships are dynamic. Are we ready to accept that and keep moving from time to time? Right? Then Sridevi also says, mindfulness workshop was awesome, like Dr. Ali's team, classical and grateful. Yes, to all of you who were not there in the mindfulness workshop, we are going to do it once more in the first Saturday of July. I forgot the date. And Anish will show you. We still have time. She'll make a poster and put it up and you'll get to know the date. The same thing, it's the first Saturday of the month in July. And it will be the same timing as we have done earlier, 10 to 1. In fact, after getting a lot of feedback on that workshop that I did, I am also going to, you know, modify it and hopefully improve it quite significantly. Okay, Sridevi Srinivas says, when we act like creepers, looking for more people to give us support, it's also important to be accountable for maintaining our own emotional stability. Yes. This brings me to a very nice concept. Depending on somebody, like the creeper is dependent on the tree around which it goes, right? There's a thing called dependence.
And there's a thing called interdependence. If you are getting something from the tree, are you giving back something? So wherever you have a relationship, are you giving in that relationship, or are you only taking? Are you only the creeper which gives nothing to the big tree? Then either the tree may collapse, or the tree may not like you and shirk you off, or other creepers may come and take the place. So many things can happen. That is what we need to keep in mind. Sharayu from Dharwad, Dr. Sharayu says, certain amount of dependency may create to feel special effect. Yes, but dependency creating that specialness is an illusion. If my child or my spouse keeps telling me that you are great, I can't live without you, you are the only person in my life, and this and that, it can create an illusion. Tomorrow I may not hold that position. Like I said, differences come in between spouses. Children get independent of their parents. Siblings can drift away from each other, however close they were when they were growing up. So understand and accept it. Lakshmi says, good afternoon, everyone. Very deep and insightful topic, sir. You shed light on some of the unspoken aspects of our lives. I guess we go on to assume and take our closed ones for granted, thinking no matter what we do and how we are, they will always be by my side. But we completely forget to consider their emotions and how they feel. Family members don't owe us anything, and nobody is obligated to serve us or meet our expectations. We need to understand that relationship with anybody. And that's what I keep telling. Why is it that a person who says, I love my partner and I'm willing to give my life for that person, gets so angry that wants to kill that person? Why is it that siblings who are so close to each other, the parent dies and they go hammer and tong fighting with each other in courts of law to try and get the property? So this is something we have to be ready for. And if there is an undercurrent in the relationship, you should be aware of that. You should not wait till a crisis comes up. Sri Devi also says, that used to happen with my mother, sir, as my mother-in-law used to demand my services because of her health issues. And I used to enjoy her company because of her cooperation. To serve her better, I feel. Yes, that's what I'm saying. Just because my mother was the most important person in my life after my marriage, that may not be the case. And it is up to the mother to understand, accept, and move on. Okay. Roshan says, no need to feel special. I truly love myself and there is no need for me to feel special. If at all one wants to feel special, it may lead to disappointment. That's what I've been saying, that it becomes dependency and not interdependency, right? My goal is to be happy always, and making myself special to someone may lead to disappointment. Very well said. And that is what I am cautioning you throughout this session. Yes, Surekha says, does the need to feel special come from our basic needs of belonging and acceptance? Yes, Surekha. We all have a basic need of belonging and acceptance. Nothing wrong with that. But what I am emphasizing is overdoing something. I love to eat food. I enjoy good food. I appreciate when the food is cooked very well and served to me. But if I become a foodie, if my life revolves around food, what is that old equation that some people, live to eat and some people eat to live? If you're eating to live and enjoying it, fine. But if you live to eat, food becomes so important in your life that you start becoming dependent on your, desire for food, you're making a big mistake. Tomorrow you may not get that type of food and you feel very, very disappointed. Yes, Vinita says, hi, Ali. feel good if we feel special to someone, but we should keep in mind that it should be cherished and not become a habit, or we become very dependent. I will give a simile of going on a vacation. You have a desire to go to a particular place on the hillside or beach, or go visit some particular country which you have never visited. So you have this desire for a vacation. You save up the money, you get the time for it, you work out everything, and you go. And it is amazing. That experience enriches your life. You feel so nice those days that you spent on your vacation. But remember, you have to come back to your daily life. If you think that you can live the way you live vacation forever, there is going to be a disappointment, isn't it? So enjoy that vacation, cherish it, have good memories about it, but get back to your regular routine. Yes, same thing Roshan is saying, no need to feel special. If you truly love yourself, the need to feel special may lead to disappointment and frustration. That's exactly what I'm trying to convey, and I want you to please keep this thing in mind. Be conscious of these things, that unless and until I am conscious and I work myself in that area, I am likely to get into disappointments, frustrations, feeling of helplessness, and most important, feeling of loneliness. Surekha says, if feeling special becomes unhealthy, then it can lead to a lack of empathy and unhealthy competition also. Yes, that's a wonderful point that you brought out, Surekha. I've seen people who want to be more special to somebody, and when they realize they are not, they start unhealthy competition. And this is competition, I'm not saying in that business sense. I mentioned to you that a mother loves a child very much and feels that I'm the most special person in my son's life, but the son gets married and starts spending more affection and attention on his wife. The mother is no longer the most special person. So what does she do? She starts competing. She starts an unhealthy competition. Anything like that among siblings, that sibling rivalry in the innocent childhood stage is okay. But as you grow up, if there is a sense of, you know, inadequacy within myself, low self-esteem, then I will do anything and everything to prove to my parent that I am better than my sibling. These are things which can be very, very painful, and we need to guard ourselves against it. Roshan says, everybody in the club makes me feel special, though I am not longing for that. So much of respect and love I get from the staff and my friends that I feel top of the world. That's how it should be. You're getting it, enjoy it. For any reason, you do not get it tomorrow, or you don't get it from one person, you get it only from another person. So be it. What's so great about it, right? Okay, Surekha says, does the need to feel special make you an emotional beggar? See, the basic need to feel special may not make you an emotional beggar, but you are likely to succumb to that or head towards that. When I have this great desire to feel special, and if I'm not getting it, and if I don't have alternatives, the chances are that I become an emotional beggar. And that's what I was saying. That may even lead to unhealthy competition. People go out of the way to be nasty to somebody. People play games, as they say in transactional analysis. You know, you play games to get somebody's affection or somebody's attention. And it can be very hurtful, not only to the person with whom you are playing these games, but in the long run, even to you. That is something to think about. My job is just to provoke your mind and think over. Like Surekha says, when we want to feel special but don't really need it, then we are better disposed to form nourishing rather than toxic relationship. Exactly. That is what I'm saying. That's why I said, no, use good relationships as the dessert, not as your basic food. Relationships should enrich, and then it will not be toxic. It will be healthy. So keeping this in mind, please work on it. anytime, anything, you know that I'm available. You can get back to me if you have any doubts or you want to contribute something. And as I always remind you, any topics that you feel would be relevant or would be interesting. I do keep getting a lot of suggestions, but I'm open to more of suggestions. I plan out generally 3-4 weeks in advance so that I, you know, get things together and put them in proper place and all that. But beyond that, I can add on any of these suggestions or topics that you are giving me. Right now, I'm going to sign off with telling you the topic for next Saturday, which Anis has put on now, nature as therapy. You heard of a lot of therapies, not only the talking therapies as in counseling and psychotherapy, but other therapies, be it yoga, be it art therapy, be it dance therapy, be it whatever it is. But this is something which not many people have given attention to. I have been working on this thing since quite some time. Nature can be a great therapy, and it does not require any other individual or human being to come to your, you know, rescue and help you and all that. And if you make it a habit to use nature as a therapy by itself, you can enrich your life. Before I knock off, Madhuri says, hello, Ali, sorry, missed listening to you. A long time since I attended these sessions, loving it. I usually ask my students if it's better to be a part of someone's world than becoming their world. Very well said, Madhuri. Is it better to, you know, be a part of someone's world rather than becoming their world? As one role is of empowerment and the other is of dependency. So accept, love, respect yourself first. Thank you very much. And I sign off, and Anis will close the session.